Hi everybody, thank you so much for joining me here today. My name is Kim Kobajek and I am a forensic scientist. Just to give you a little bit about my background, I have been in forensic science for well over 20 years, including being a practicing forensic scientist in a crime laboratory for both the city and the state. And I've also been a clinical associate professor here at Arizona State University at the West Campus, where we have a forensic science undergraduate degree. Now, forensic science, you may know that it's a very popular topic, and once upon a time, everybody didn't really know what the job of a forensic scientist was. But now, with CSI, all of these different crime shows, now you have an interest in forensic science. You have, like I said, university degrees. You have concentrations that you can do, and even at the high school and junior high level, you have elective classes. So this means this is a science in which you can do research. But if you're not a forensic scientist, or if you're not familiar with it, how do you develop an eye cure to use with your students? That's why I'm here today, and I'm going to discuss with you not only the eye cure that I did with my students here at ASU West, but I'm going to introduce you to some common methods that are used within the crime laboratory, but are also easily used outside of the crime laboratory by instructors and students alike. So as they say, forensic science starts at the crime scene, so let's go to the crime scene. So this crime scene, we are going to be looking at different types of evidence. When you get to a crime scene, you really don't know what type of evidence you could be looking for. And oftentimes there is visible evidence as well as latent evidence. And in the eye cure that I did with my students here at Arizona State University, that was the focus of our research, was the detection of latent forensic evidence. Now that's a very broad topic, but if you think about it, latent or invisible can mean a lot of different things. It could mean blood that could have been washed away. It could mean latent fingerprints. It could mean trace DNA or trace evidence. So as I said, we're going to look through a few different procedures that, like I said, are usable in the crime lab as well as in the laboratory setting. So here in our crime scene, we're looking at some visible blood stains, and we can see fairly clearly on this bottle opener here the presence of red-brown staining. It also looks very shiny in appearance, kind of like a candy apple red, on different areas of this item. But what might be less apparent is some red-brown staining that looks wiped on the table. So what I'm going to do here, this is just a regular flashlight. I am going to light this up at an oblique angle, or an angle that is perpendicular to the blood or possible blood, and you can see it just a little bit clearer on the table. And again, this is a common tool, the flashlight, that is used at the crime scene. So this here is also some possible blood on the knife. It has that similar red-brown characteristic. But one thing to point out is, in comparison to your bottle opener, the blood does look different. And that is something that is going to be observed both at the crime scene as well as in the laboratory. And we'll visit the laboratory later to kind of give you a better idea of how blood can look different on different surfaces, which could be an idea for a good research project. So this looks like blood. How do I tell if it is blood? Well, one of the things that is commonly used at the crime scene, as well as in the crime laboratory, is an indicator test. These indicator tests for blood are presumptive only, meaning they don't identify blood, and they don't identify human blood, but They are fairly specific to the protein heme, which is in blood, and gives the crime scene specialist or the forensic scientist a good idea that blood is probably there. Now, the test that is commonly used is the Kastle Meyer test. And this is a three-step test, and it's fairly simple. You take a drop of deionized water, and then you can gently swab a portion of the stain, which will then transfer a small amount of stain onto the swab. After you have a small amount of the stain transferred onto the sterile swab, you can start performing the Kastle Meyer three-step reagent test. And like I said, we'll visit the lab a little bit later and go into more detail about how this test works and what these reagents actually are. So step one is adding a drop of the Kastle Meyer A reagent. And at this point, there should not be a color reaction seen. Then we will add the second reagent, a couple drops here. This will be a little bit harder to get out. And you want to make sure that you don't touch the tip of the swab to the reagent. Now at this point, we still see just that color of the stain onto the swab. And after we add this third reagent, reagent C, we should see a brilliant pink color indicating a positive reaction. So this is a positive reaction for the indication of blood. Again, it's not human specific. It is not specific to blood. There are things that can cross-react with this test. But the fact that this test may have some false positives is actually a good thing in terms of developing an eye cure. This is something that students can actually investigate further. So we saw, I'm going to perform one more Kastle Meyer test. We saw that this was a pretty concentrated stain of possible blood. Now I'm going to perform that same test on that different appearance of blood here on the table. So again, I added a little bit of deionized water to the end of my sterile swab. I am going to transfer a little bit of that stain onto the swab, and then I am going to perform my three-step Kastle Meyer test with reagent A, reagent B, if you cooperate. You know, anything in science, it's not going to be perfect. That is all part of the experience. Okay, and then reagent C. And again, we have this bright pink color within 10 seconds, which is indicative of a positive, presumptive, or indicator test for blood. So we've done our tests, and now this evidence would be collected and sent back to the laboratory for further testing. Now, when we go back to the lab, we'll further discuss the Kastle Meyer tests, some other indicator tests that could be used, as well as some common false positives that you want to be aware of when you're using this test. So let's go to the lab.